Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Anthony Robbins.
How are you doing this morning? Grab a hug and a seat. Oh my goodness. Murphy's Law. How many are having a great time in spite of that? Say aye. Fantastic. Please grab a seat. Well, we got the warmest days with no wind, which is very, very rare here, especially on this side. And as you know, last night, what happened to our air conditioning. So we, fortunately, with God's grace, normally have a program going on here called Life Mastery. People come here for 6 days. Somebody bumped into some of those people before they left here. You see them flying pretty high. They've gone through a process that allows them to focus on their body, their mind, their emotions, their relationships, their finances. But the whole week really is kind of a seduction because we bring them in to transform their body. And while they're here during that time, they eat nothing. They go on a fast. Now, it's not a total fast where your body breaks down. There are all kinds of fasts. But we give them essential oils, and we give them certain fundamentals, and they do Libby's or colonics, if you're familiar with that. And they haven't eaten for 4 or 5 days, and stuff is still coming out of their system. They're going, where has this come from? Who's been through Life Mastery and knows what I'm talking about? And the first day or two, they're miserable. Anybody know what makes them miserable? Are they really hungry, yes or no? No, because their body's getting what it needs, and about the second day in, they realize they're not hungry. They're just pissed. And what is it? What is it? What is the part of them that's making them pissed since their physical needs are truly being met? In fact, what happens about the fourth day in, third day in for most of them? All of a sudden, they have this euphoria. They wake up with causeless joy. What happens is you're no longer driven and controlled by your mind. You're no longer every moment going, I got to eat something. Because after a while, they start going, I'm not really hungry, but I got to eat something. What do you got to eat something for? Because you're bored. What do you eat something for? Because you're unfulfilled. Why do you eat something right now? Even though you don't need anything. Something to do. Because when we're left alone with ourselves, without enough stimulation, running full tilt, then we have to actually start asking some other questions that we're trying to hide from. Because they're big questions, and for some people, they're scary questions for most people. And until you break through that process, and you get beyond your fear. And the interesting about fear is what we're afraid of is not really that bad. I always say, you know, fear at least has a resolution. You're either afraid and you're right and you deal with the pain, or you're wrong and you don't have to be afraid anymore. It gets done. Anxiety never ends. The number one emotion that people in North America have, by the way, all the studies, is anxiety. Because anxiety is that dull thing that's eating at you all the time that you want to avoid by staying busy. And this experience this week is a different kind of detoxification. That one's physical, but you can't separate the physical from the psychological. And when they get beyond that, that's the euphoria you saw when they're leaving, out of their mind, greatest week of their life. Who would have thought not eating and, you know, eliminating things out of my bum would really make me this happy? But it does. It's, you talk to anybody there, it's life-changing. You talk to them 10 years later, it's life-changing. They develop a regimen usually to give them a little balance at least once a year to make that happen. This experience, for some of you, I know this is not a new experience because of this being an opening. Many of you are obviously not just initiates, but you're real, you know, blessing givers that have been here for some time or coordinators. But I was thinking last night, you know, this is a very different experience last night. It's not how the university will normally start. It's because it was the opening ceremonies and the auspiciousness of that and that process. So going late, doing all the things we're going to do there, and, of course, dealing with the logistics that were there. But if you're new and you're not someone who's socially conscious in your mindset, maybe you're more of an achiever or not as socially conscious, you might at this stage really be wondering what you got yourself into. Oh, I see a few of those. There they are. Like, what the hell was that shit last night? Because normally we would introduce you more gently, as we're going to do this morning, by starting with a pragmatic part of your life and really just showing you those areas. Because for most of my life, that's been my focus, is, you know, be that Trojan horse. Meet people where they live. Trying to influence somebody with what you believe in most cases, a waste of time, especially if what they already believe is a conviction. The best way to influence somebody is know what already influences them and meet their needs. And if you do that, you develop a different level of trust than if you just say stuff or if you're just enthusiastic. And some people, by the way, think that's what I am. I can remember, for example, in the very beginning here, when I first, went to India, I went to India when I was 21 years old. I went to go to a place called Ganesh Puri, and I met a really amazing man there who I had tremendous love and respect for, but I wasn't moved physically, physiologically. There wasn't a shift in me. There was just this incredible respect for this man. And I didn't go there either because I really wanted to go there. I went there basically to kind of take care of some business, and somebody else who was a big, follower of this man was my business partner. I thought they were going to go off the edge. That's why I went, really. But I was really touched, but not transformed. When I went to this time, really to see what I could do, anything else I could do to try and save my wife's life, I wasn't looking for something. But that's when you often get interrupted with what you need. And so I say that because if you're one of those people that's kind of wondering, I think I should, the mind loves surprises, doesn't it? How many love surprises? Say I. Bullshit. You love the surprises you want. You have the surprises that you kind of hope happen, and they do, and you call it a surprise, and you're excited. But we don't like surprises that we don't want. Those are called problems. Those are called challenges. And yet, do we need those? Yes or no? Well, you better believe it, because that's what makes us grow, which is one of the core essences of life, one of the core human needs. So maybe first what we should do is kind of give you your mind some expectation that's more aligned with what we're going to do. Two people came here that I just met recently, and when they arrived that morning, first thing is, tell us what's going to happen. We went for 2 or 3 hours of conversation about, different things, but it was like, what's going to happen? We always want to know what's next, what's going to occur, how we can prepare ourselves. But also that creates an expectation that if it isn't met, how do we usually feel? Unhappy. How many have ever had an unmet expectation and been pissed off about it? How many have had this happen more than once in your lifetime? Say I. How many think it will happen in the future? Say I. How many still feel it's intelligent to expect like crazy? Say I. But we still do. It's the nature of the mind. So as long as the mind's engaged, let's give it some hope or some sense of what we're going to do. This program is not my program. This program is designed by Bhagwan, but when I met Bhagwan, we created this incredible connection. When I first arrived, I'll never forget, I came in the room, and I now had 3 or 4 days of experience. And, I'd already had the experience, the transformation of sage. I had experiences that blew my mind, that as a pragmatic guy, I would have gone, that's foo-foo, they're not really doing this, they're making it up, they're hypnotizing themselves. So I knew the impact. And when I came in, the first thing he said is, we've been waiting for you. And I looked at my watch, and I'm on time. I want to be respectful, right? He said, no. He said, for years. And I said, really? And then he just went on about this whole prophecy and talked about how he had watched the films. How many have been through Date with Destiny? Some of you, quite a few of you, wow. Well, that's where I know many of you probably came from, had your first experience of the blessing. Well, he got to watch some of the films and some of the work I've done with people who are going to commit suicide, a child, an adult, some of the other people. And they had all these people that had been within the movement, came to talk to him and so forth. And he said, I've watched those films myself. He said, but more importantly, I experienced your presence. And he said, you can help bridge between the Eastern and Western. Because that's the challenge many of you are going to have this week. Those of you who are achievers, you're ready to rock and roll and just do this. Come on, let's go. Give me the juice. All right? I got to India, and the first thing they said after flying 24 hours so I could get this frickin' blessing was, take a day and relax. How about a day and frickin' relax? I flew 24 hours to be here. Give me the juice. No, Radhakrishna says, relax. Relax. Right? I'm here to accomplish achievement. I want to achieve enlightenment, awakenment. And that's how achievers go after it. They try to achieve awakenness, enlightenment, or something else. Right? And so when things don't go in a straight line from here to there, they think something's wrong. But they don't just do it when they're somewhere else. They do it with themselves all the time, and that's a great source of pain. Because nature abhors a straight line. Show me a straight line in nature. You won't find it. Man creates straight lines. The illusion that life is like that. The illusion that this is even solid. When if we just take a microscope and we just enhance our perceptions, we see there is nothing solid. There is nothing straight. Everything evolves. It moves. I don't care if it's a tree, a bush, anything that's going to grow. It does move forward or up, but not straight. If it moves straight, you'd be bored as hell. You'd have nothing to engage you, nothing to make you grow. And so all the things, the surprises we hate, are life offering us the opportunity to experience more of it. So as an achiever, we tend to miss that. And as an achiever, you want to get the stuff, make it happen. And trust me, you know, there's a huge part of me that's an achiever. And I've lived my life figuring out how to do that, because my achievement has been, how do I really touch as many people as possible? How I enter the world and influence the people that aren't being influenced. Somebody socially conscious is already pursuing some form of enlightenment. So for the achiever here, you know, the surprises are not wonderful things, but you may discover the most wonderful thing is the surprises you don't want here. You may discover the thing that's upsetting you the most or does not fit your model of the world, your blueprint of how it's supposed to be, could be the greatest gift that's ever happened in your life, because it's a pattern interrupt that can free you from the mind, which is nothing but a pattern. A pattern. Some of you here have been in programs we have. We've got tens of thousands of people, and so you're ready, the music goes, and you rock. And I'm sure a few of you here who come from the oneness community are like, what have they done? This is not spiritual. What is this clapping crap? We should be sitting. This is irritating to me. I'm sure there must be some out there with nervous laughs who can identify what I'm talking about, because they also have a blueprint of how it's supposed to be. Right? It's quiet. It's silent. It's calm. Word one. This is what's truly spiritual. But if you watch these dasajis, or if you're with them outside this environment, outside the traditional environment of the East, they also have a Western part of them. And I have seen it. I remember the first time they all came here and they were excited, like little boys. We had such a great time. I said, come with me. And I surprised them. And we have a waterfall here that you'll want to make a little journey to. It's not very far. It's beautiful. And in order for Bhagwan to be able to come here because of his physical nature, I built actually a walkway so that he and Amma could walk all the way up to the waterfall and sit down. So I took him up this walkway So I took off my clothes and jumped in, and they all looked at me like I was insane. And then all of a sudden, I think it may have been Uptama, right? Because, of course, he's the one, the universal one here, the awakening one here. I think he jumped in next, and all of a sudden, they were all in the water and were soaked and just laughing and splashing and screaming. Shit you wouldn't think is very spiritual. Dancing. Like little boys. See, this idea that you're one kind of person is the greatest source of your pain. This idea you're supposed to be a certain person that you're not is the greatest source of your pain. And everybody has it. It's just a matter of how engaged is it in this moment. And the reason we all have it is we're all born with a unique spiritual essence, like a fingerprint, I believe. And it's unique for everybody. I don't think there's anybody identical. I think that's the unique thing that creation is. But we're also born with one thing in common that's true for every person in this room. And if you can own this in your heart, not your head, then when somebody does something that makes you crazy or you're mad or you're hurt, you can remember it's not about you. You're just caught up in yourself right now. It's them stumbling through this challenge that we're all born completely vulnerable. There's not a person in this room who isn't. I don't give a shit what you've accomplished. I don't care how spiritual you are. I don't care how much you can channel the blessing. You're vulnerable. So am I. But we spend most of our life learning that that's not enough. By the way, when you're vulnerable, how hard is it to connect with somebody if they're also vulnerable? It's natural, because there is no separation. It's fear that separates us. It's the illusion that I am something different than you, and that I have to become somebody. I have to be something. I have to be somebody. It's that need for significance. And then there's a physiological process that we go under that makes us physiologically start out as a child connected to everything. We think everybody feels what we feel. Isn't it true? And then enter a world where all of a sudden we develop this sense of self, a sense of division, which has enormous value. It's like the East and the West. The Eastern approach, you could go to the East, and if you're a Western, you go, look at these people in such poverty. But other people go, look at these people have such joy from nothing. So that's what we should do. We should go to the East and have joy with nothing. Some of us go, let's slow that process down a little bit. sounds good till I experience it. Because what most Westerners do is they go to the East and they experience a Western East, Eastern joy, Western lifestyle. Now, when you go to the, you know, up until just recently, we've made this change here, and you're going to India, you're staying with 18 people. Yeah, that was a new experience for most Westerners. 21 days, interesting food. And if you have any complex of starting on time, this has been the most magnificent schedule you'll ever experience compared to that. Right? So it's a rough mode. But celebrities, influential people, of course, got little different experience, but it's still a different experience. The point is, you're going to find that what Bhagwan believes, and this is what he shared with me, is the East is not right, and nor is the West. He said the beautiful thing about the West is people's creativity, their resourcefulness, their ability to use the mind to serve the greater good of humanity, to produce, to make happen, to create a greater quality of life materially, and for someone to engage their resources. It's extraordinary what the West has created. Bhagwan. He said the East has found the way to reconnect with the oneness. And as long as we're a physical incarnation, you must do both. And the illusion that one is spiritual, one is not, is nothing but your old model of the world, your old blueprint of trying to find a way a long time ago when it wasn't enough to be vulnerable. When vulnerability equaled what? Who knows what? Pain. We all experience pain. And the reason is we lived in an environment where we were completely dependent upon another human being for our survival. Isn't it true? So that person had what we call love us. When you love somebody, what will you do for them? What? Anything. Is it a trade? I'll do this for you if you do this for me. Is that what it is? And if they don't, you're pissed off and you're hurt and you're angry. No, that's not love. Love is you give it. People, I often see men or women whose best relationship is not their spouse, it's their children. Because they're not scared there. They're not afraid they're going to leave them or hurt them. Because subconsciously, no, they're fucked. They're dependent upon me. Little bastard's going to take care of me, going to love me, because if they don't, I got control. So guess what? We love unconditionally our children, most of us, but we don't love each other unconditionally. We sense their vulnerability is more than our own, and so we step up. We don't sense that in our partner. Because of the words they've used, or the way they used their face, or the way they touched, or they said something that broke the rules of the game, like that word I just used. See, we all have these reactions, because early on, you learned you had to be a certain way in order to survive. Emotionally, physically. And where did you learn that from? The greatest source of love in your life that you desired most, or you desired and was withheld, either one, has shaped your mind and has controlled the meaning of your life and the way you live even today. And you can have multiple sources. One of the earliest was whoever took care of you, because all of us here were born totally vulnerable. We couldn't survive. So someone took care of us, even if you don't think they did a good job, and even if you don't think they loved you. They did. And they loved you no matter what you were like. If you were born, you know, and you look like a lizard, you were still loved. It's true. Fathers go, that's a lizard. Mothers go, no, that's our child, right? Why? Why do all mothers think their child is beautiful, don't they? Tell me a mother. They show this child with one tooth sticking out, face here, drooling, fat, beautiful. Why? Because they're drugged. They have oxytocin, a natural drug in their body that makes them love this child, even though they look like a lizard, beautifully. Real love, like give anything to that child, survive for that child. There's a cat walking around here that obviously has been really hungry, and she's nursing, and you can see she's skin and bones, but her child is totally plump. As it really touched me, I was looking there going, wow, isn't God, isn't nature amazing? That's love. You don't have to sacrifice for love, but sometimes you do. Not always. The point is really simple. You learned at that stage that you had to do what to be loved as a baby. When you're a brand new baby, what do you got to do to be loved? What? What? Nothing. Nada. Squat, zip, zilch. Nothing. You spit in your love. You poop in your pants. Oh, green poop. That's cool. Right? You know? You burp. It doesn't matter what. You scream. What do you got to do to get what you want? Anything. Make some noise, coo, anything. You know, you do enough of anything, it's going to come together. But you know where we always, everyone in this room, every human being I've ever met, and when you understand this, we all are vulnerable because we all still have fear. And the fear started one day when that game stopped. Not completely, just stopped. Unconditional love stopped. Because one day that oxytocin wore off. Because any healthy mother, biochemically healthy, cannot leave their child unless they have a biochemical shift in them. It's a fact. Men get oxytocin too when they have a child. Not as much though. Men can leave. A biologically balanced woman cannot. But there is a stage when that wears off and suddenly you do all the same things and you don't get unconditional love. You get someone yelling at you or smacking you or the very worst thing of all, you get ignored. And that's a scary moment in your life. It's when fear enters your life, and that's when the two fears we all have show up. We all fear that we're not enough, because suddenly I was enough, and now I'm not getting any attention, I'm not getting survival, I'm not getting love. I mean, if a baby isn't physically loved, any doctors in the room, what happens to them? They develop something called what? Failure to thrive syndrome. They physically die if they're not physically loved and touched. This is how desperately we need love. It's a spiritual cyclic source of life. And then all of a sudden it's gone, so what does a baby do? You figured out a way to adapt. Maybe you scream louder, that didn't work. But if you try to like do something and you fell down, every mother knows the difference in that cry, don't they? Bam, and she comes running. And if they come running when you're hurt, hurt come running. Oh, brain goes, I know how to adapt. And now they're 40 and they still got a problem to get their friends around them all the time. They're always a victim. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Someone else that you know. Right? Or if no one comes, what does the baby do? Maybe the baby tries to, for the first time, wants to be connected. So the baby wants that connection, that oneness again. So the baby starts to try to crawl. And someone goes, oh my God, look at, Kathy's crawling, Charlie's crawling, oh my God. Everybody comes, all this attention. Boom, what happens? An achiever is born. In that moment, I always figure out, what do I need to do so that people know that I'm enough and they will love me? Who knows somebody that you could relate this to? Somebody else, I know somebody else. Or one day a baby's not being paid attention to and they finally give up and they just go, and people start to laugh. A comedian is born. Now I'm oversimplifying this, but you get the idea? We all have two deep fears. Number one, that we're not enough. There's no human being on earth that doesn't have it. I've been with 3.5 million people, almost four now, from 100 countries, from presidents to kids, people in prison, people addicted to drugs, people that are leading, athletes, I don't care who it is. They all, in the quiet moments, have this fear they're not enough. They may not have it right now in this moment, because right now, their life conditions kind of match how they think it should be. But there's only a matter of time till someone is more attractive, stronger, smarter, has more freedom, seems to be happier. How many can relate to a time where you felt like you weren't enough? Smart enough, attractive enough, playful enough, spiritual enough, something enough. Who can relate to this? Say, I. Those moments, what do they really feel like when you really engage them? They're scary. That's that sick feeling in your stomach. Because the real fear below it, the deepest fear is if I'm not enough, I won't be loved. Because we don't have unconditional love anymore. Now if you just, not everybody laughs and comes and runs. You know, it's okay to poop in your pants, but if you're 40, we got a problem. You know? Right? When you're a child, when you're a baby, you got fat cheeks, you're really fat, you're considered to be what? Cute. Try that when you're 50, see if it works for you. Okay? The rules change completely. And we all know that inside. And it freaks us out inside. So that fear, we compensate. And early on, when we got this taken from us, we learned that we had to be a certain way to get that source of love to give us that connection again, give us that love. We had to be significant enough to them, some way. If we couldn't be significant in a good way, be significant in a bad way, break something, drop something, anything to get that connection, that at least something approximating moving towards oneness again. No more separation. Separation equals suffering, pain. Who is the greatest source of love for you? Your mother? Your father? Maybe you didn't know your mother or father. A grandma, grandpa, uncle, and aunt? Someone who adopted you? Someone who took care of you? Whose love did you crave and not get enough of? if anyone's. You want to know what controls your life? Think about, who did you have to be for that person? How did you have to be? A good person, a strong person, a funny person, an obedient person, a person that met all their needs, a person who was successful, strong, resourceful. Better yet, who could you never be if you're honest? If you were like that, pain. Ignored, not enough, pissed off at you, nagged at you, frustrated you, grounded you, again, ignored you. Someone tell me the answer to the question, just as an example. Who was the greatest source of love in your life that you wanted love from the most? You may have loved both people, but even if you love both people, it's an interesting thing. If they both love you, but one was more engaged, more busy with other things, even if they loved you, even if you knew it intellectually, it develops often a hunger, doesn't it? So I'm going to give you an example. Yes. Your mother. You wanted the love of your mother the most? And who did you have to be in order to have your mother's love?
I had to be a good girl, productive, innovative, be initiating stuff.
Good girl, productive, innovative, initiate. And if you did that, how did she respond?
Positively.
Pardon me?
Positively.
And how, in what way positively? What would she do?
She would praise me.
Mm-hmm.
And tell me that I was a good girl.
Tell you, praise you, give you attention.
Mm-hmm. A little.
A little. Did you hear that? Did you see her? Did you hear her voice on that? A little. Because what you see here is there's still that hunger even today. That. Who could you never be for your mother? Who could you not be?
Lazy, fat, disobedient.
Lazy, fat, disobedient.
Naughty.
Naughty. Oh, don't be naughty. And yet, did you just see what happened? I said, don't be naughty. Was that cute? Now I want you to notice something. Not cute intellectually cute. It was cute because that she is naughty. How many saw that? Raise your hand if you saw that. That's why she spontaneously, without even, while she was intellectually thinking, she was in trance, and I asked the question, boom, you got a real reaction, not a constructive reaction. She likes being naughty, yet being naughty means losing the love of the source of love that matters most to you in life. That might create a little inner conflict. By the way, are you lazy at times?
Rarely.
Rarely, I bet. Can you imagine if love was taken, if you're lazy, would you really ever allow yourself to experience that part of yourself on any consistent basis? By the way, are you an initiator?
Yes.
Yes, she was the first person to raise her hand. Are you innovative?
Yes.
Yes. Are you a good girl?
Mostly.
Do you hear that nice little conflict going on there? Right? Are you overweight? And I'm not saying this in a harsh way, because what you have to know with me is, I want you to get to the truth. I have zero judgment. I'm here only to serve you. But to do that, you have to go to the truth, even if you don't like that in your rules. How many follow I'm talking about? If you know me, you know that I'm not here to hurt anybody. Are you overweight, though?
Yes.
How does that work for your mom?
It doesn't.
Is it a source of conflict?
Yeah, it does. She feels, her words to me is that she's felt like a failure because I'm fat.
She feels what? I'm sorry.
Like a failure because I'm fat.
She's a failure because you're overweight. I don't know that fat is accurate or not. Maybe it is. I don't know. That's for you to decide. But you're definitely overweight. Your body's not being served 100% physically. By the way, that might create a dynamic inside that if you know there's a point, you have to be a certain way, a certain way, a certain way, and it's so stressful, you might eat as a way to get out of that state. Because when you eat, it immediately changes what we call your physiology, which is, by the way, what we're going to do here in a different way without a downside. With a blessing. So there's a way to try to get out of those internal battles that can't be resolved. How much do you want love, my friends? I don't know about you, but I would die for it. That's why I do what I do. I used to get up on stage because I'm such a lover. I wanted to give every ounce, and I thought if I sacrifice enough, this is my blueprint, you sacrifice enough. I learned this from my mom. If you sacrifice, if you hurt, if nothing works, if you get nothing and you keep doing these things for me, then I will know you really love me. You weren't just saying it. But I'm such a love bug. I didn't just want my mom. I wanted the whole world because I was hungry for it, very hungry. And so I found this cool thing. I found a way to help myself, and my friends saw what happened to me when I was a kid. I'm talking 15, 14. First thing was reading Losing Weight because I was overweight and always small. 5'1" in high school. First year in high school, true story. I'm now 6'7". I tell them the difference is personal growth. It's true though, I grew 10 inches in a year. I had a tumor, it's a different story. Tumor I was even unaware of, pituitary tumor, my brain made me grow 10 inches in a year. But the point of the matter is, my friends saw I lost this weight and they asked me, and I wasn't, you know, a popular kid of my little buddies, and none of us were really that popular girls, and I was always the girl's best friend. I hated that shit. And they did too. And so I said, do this, and it worked. And not only it lit them up, I live today. The reason I'm here today still is I live to see that light in people's eyes when they remember who they are. I live for that. I'll do anything for that. It makes me feel like I'm living my purpose. Why I am here on this earth. And it gives me a joy that's unbelievable. And frankly, it's a hell of a deal because I get so much love. I can't walk down the street anywhere in this world without the privilege of being stopped a dozen times in a day and somebody coming up and saying a phrase, and anybody around me will know it, 90%, you changed my life. And I said, no, you changed it. Glad I helped. What was it? And I never get tired of hearing the stories. It's an unbelievable experience. And it started when I was 14 years old. But once that hooked, I thought, wow, this is a cool thing. And I love to learn, so I learned something else, made a change in me, share with my friends, they lit up, and by the time, you know, in high school, I was Mr. Solution. You got the problem, I got a solution. Especially if you're a girl, I really wanted additional, had plenty of motivation then to assist. But the truth was that anyone, that was the nature of who I was. So I developed a way of living life, and it served me a lot of ways, but it also gave me enormous pain, especially what happens when you give, and you're not giving to get, but at some point you'd like some love back and it doesn't happen. How does that feel?
Really awful. Empty.
Yeah. And then all these emotions show up. And then if you get angry, is that appropriate? Yeah. Another thing you couldn't be was?
Angry.
So you're only going to love me if I'm a certain way, but I can't get angry. That's real human. This is not making your mom wrong because she has a different blueprint too. We all got pieces of our blueprint because this is what the mind does. It divides, separates, makes us evaluate and give meanings that have nothing to do with the reality of life. But the minute you give something a meaning, you're going to have an emotion about it. This is wrong. Pisses me off. This is hurtful. They try to do that. The minute. Is this the end right now or the beginning? If you think it's the end of a relationship, you're going to treat that person differently. You're going to feel differently than if you think this is the beginning of a relationship. Has God been punishing you with this temperature? With these delays? Was God challenging you? Or were there gifts that you have found or have not yet found? Whatever the meaning is, it's the truth for you. Because once you make it, you feel it. Once the feeling happens, biochemical storm takes over, pleasure storm, pain storm, but some storm. And then your behavior comes out of that. And then that gets evaluated. So we're all born in this unique place, and we all learn there's a way we need to be. And by the way, we work hard to be it because love is survival. Remember, baby's not physically held, they die. Love is survival. Love is life. Love is oneness. When you are totally in love, you disappear. Isn't it true? People talk about meditation. I never was interested in meditation. It's a meditation. Well, I'm with somebody I love, and we're going back and forth, and you know, you're helping somebody. That's my meditation, because what happens in meditation? Same thing as in love. When you're totally in love, the first thing that happens is time disappears. True or false?
True.
Isn't it true? Even if you love what you're doing, time disappears. If you love who you're with, time disappears. If you're loving the experience, time just doesn't seem to exist. Time flies. How long is a long time? A minute, an hour, 6 months, 20 years? Depends on whether you're enjoying it or not, right? A minute can feel like an eternity. Hours can go by and go, where'd the time go? It has nothing with the experience. It's the meaning you give it. Meaning equals emotion. Emotion is life. Because everything you do comes from that fuel. Even if you're a purely intellectual creature, you're still evaluating what will give you pain or pleasure at some level unconsciously. But the weird thing is, we're running all this off a system that got designed a hell of a long time ago. And it can't possibly be all of you. And here's where the real problem is. We feel alive when we no longer feel separate. But how can you ever connect to another human being, no matter how much you think it's them that's creating your pain, when you are not being all of yourself? When you are not one with your whole self? And we all do this because we're vulnerable, and we learn these parts of me are good, these parts of me is what I need to be, and you work hard at it, and you are how many of you are damn good at a lot of things you needed to be in order to get love? How many would say that would be fair? How many of you avoid those things you were not supposed to be for the most part? Let me see. Even today, at an unconscious level, isn't it interesting? Even today, 21 years later, man, 30, okay, whatever. You get the idea? And so what happens is, the more you try to not be something you are, the more pain you have, because there's separation inside of you. And then you're trying to connect with somebody else who's only thinking parts of them are okay and separating from others. And two partial people don't make a whole. In fact, they just engage each other. And you almost always attract the person at some level that you're attracted to, very often opposites, aren't you? I'll see very, very feminine woman who has made that part of herself wrong, but she had to become strong and powerful, make things happen. And she can do anything a man can do times two or three or four, without exaggerating. Kick ass. And so she finds a partner. And she's looking at that partner and saying, so glad you're here. And inside she's going, why don't you fucking do something? But why? She's attracted the part of herself that she's denied, the part of her that could actually do nothing and be happy with it. The part of her that she makes wrong. Or maybe it's not your intimate partner, maybe it's your son or daughter. You're an achiever, right? And so you want a child, a boy or girl who's going to be this incredible achiever, and they sort of do it because they want your love, but they just don't seem to have the same fuel you've got. They're not as driven as you, are they? Oh, good guess with you, sir, wasn't it? And it makes you freaking crazy. What have I done wrong? Why does this child? It's because I spoiled them. No, it's because you've not accepted that part of you. You don't have to do nothing. But if you could get over the reaction to it, if you could get comfortable with that part of yourself, you'll see a change in that relationship. More importantly, you'll see a change in you. It's like God or the universe is always trying to send you whatever part of yourself you've denied. And every human being we meet is there to bring us back to oneness. In ourself, first. If somebody, I'll tell you what makes me crazy, because my whole model is about giving, right? Gotta give, 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 give. Who do you think makes me crazy? People that take advantage of people. I want to kill them. My big heart comes out. Kill them. How can they do this? How can they be so abusive? How can they be so hurtful? How can they do this? Well, it doesn't match my model of the world. And for a long time, guess what? How many of you have a model like this where you have to always be the giver? Like, you go to dinner, you, even if you have no money, you're paying for the meal, or you're always trying to figure out, and you're always trying to make sure you give more than you get. Who fits this model? Yeah, several of you. So how many of you have found you attract people that are more than willing to take you up on this offer? This went on for me for years and years and years. And finally I went, it's not them. There's a lesson here. So I thought the lesson was avoid those kinds of people. Have more perception, right? You know, or, you know, don't do business with them. Certainly they're not my friends. But one day I figured out, you know what my problem is? My problem is, I really am a person that's taking, because I'm taking away the opportunity for other people to give. But see, I had to give to get love, and now I'm proud of that. I'm a giver. I love that part of myself. But to always do it every moment, it's out of balance. So do I have to become a taker to balance myself and be one? You don't take the behavior, you take the energy. into yourself. And what the lesson of that is, someone who can do that can receive. One of my sons is very driven. One of my sons pretends he's driven. And I love him so much. And he and I are the same. You know, he's got a heart like this. I mean, he really does. No bullshit. No, when no one's watching, that's when you know somebody's really like, right? And he's got a heart. I mean, I relate to my boy heart to heart, a level you can't even imagine. I'm proud of his soul. But frick, I used to be going, why can't he ever do anything with an ounce? He wants everything without any work. Me, I work 1,000 times harder than I probably need to. So that I know I've done everything humanly possible to make this occur in the most incredible way. And anybody who knows you, when I'm done with this day, I'm done an event, been on stage 50 hours in a weekend, and people are out of their mind. It was the greatest experience. The first thing I do, I'm sitting down with my creative team with a tape recorder, and okay, what worked so I can figure out how to keep it, use it, what do we need to make better? I'm relentless in that way. My son is not. What gift does he offer me? I really had to work on this one. It's obvious. He knows how to just hang. For oneness, I had no such experience in my life. None. That was the most profound thing. The first time I experienced it, I didn't move for 45 straight minutes. It was like, this. My wife said, this is a miracle. And I didn't want to move. I didn't want to do anything. And I was so filled with joy, I couldn't breathe there. It was just like overwhelming joy. I reclaimed a part of myself. So, by the way, do you lose your nature? Well, the parts of your nature that you're proud of and you now enjoy because it works for you, you continue. But you don't do it exclusively, so now you're whole. Is this making sense to you? This is what this week is about, is to bring you back to oneness. And you cannot have it. This whole experience, if you really want to bring it down to real spirituality, it's not going over and praying a certain way. It's not acting its word. It's not following a certain set of rules. It's all relationship. Relationship. When people go off and they say I have the spiritual life, I respect them. And they go off and they pray or they meditate. It's a wonderful thing. But that's easy. Because you only have to deal with you, and there aren't a bunch of stimulations around you to make you have to deal with all the other parts. Find somebody across from you who you really want their love and you really love them, who has all these other different rules and beliefs and ways of being that can get you going. Step into that place and be spiritual. Become whole within yourself and be whole with them. Now you got a path. You want a path of growth, and the only thing this is really about ultimately, life is two things. It's growing and it's giving. When you're giving and it's from your heart and your soul, you're not there. If you're loving someone, you're not in your head about you. It's about them. And so when you're not there, you're not existing, you're living. When you're not there, you feel alive. You don't have worries and fears. How do I look? How's it coming? What's it going to do? Money is just this thing going to happen? And oh, shit. You're there with them. And so you're connected to everything. Them, every essence of who they are, what you are, and everything else. You feel alive. And if you just go to that state, some people, when we first started doing this with some of my celebrity clientele and business people and a group of our platinum partners, we had a first session. It was amazing. We came back with a second session, and the first day was mind-boggling. People just sat around. They were pissed off if they had to do anything because they wanted the new drug. They wanted to get their blessing. You know what I mean by that? What's going to make me feel so euphoric instantaneously? It's not about going and getting a blessing and feeling euphoric, although you're going to experience that. Some of you each day, different ways, some of you more days than others, some of your mind will be trying to compare to the one before, and this will be as good until you finally surrender and just experience what is. But I'll tell you what's really interesting. The purpose of this is to get to a place where you have an insight, you have an experience, you have a unification with yourself. If all you have is a state, you can do that with drugs or alcohol or food or sex, and those are all wonderful things in different uses in different ways. In the right context, the right environment. But this is a tool for you not only to feel this euphoria, but while you're there, to begin to have experiences that connect you to the truth, the real reality. If you use it that way, then you have both the joy, the euphoria, the connection, the experience, and you have the growth. And if you grow, you have something to give. And you have something to give, you're back alive again. How many see what I'm saying here? So There's nothing wrong with looking forward to the state, but if that's all you do, I see people. There's a lot of people who are socially conscious. They're not really truly socially conscious. They're looking for the next hit, the next thing they can do to feel good. Whether they gave up achieving business-wise, I'm done with that, or that's not the right thing. What they're trying to do is achieve enlightenment, like it's a goal. This is not a goal. It's life. So the journey of the next few days, you're going to go through an experience of an eightfold path that can help you get out of suffering, which most people say, I'm not suffering. Most people live with suffering management. Food is a way to manage your suffering. This woman is a beautiful soul, but if you can't see she's suffering, you must be inside yourself right now, not with her. Beautiful soul suffering. A woman who give her heart, very obviously, pure giver, not selfish woman, but then beats herself up because after a while she's tired of having to be a certain way for somebody else and not just be myself, and then she'll get angry. Well, but if I'm angry, I won't be loved. And she's got this mother who drives her crazy. God's greatest gift to her, this mother, this bitch. How could she? Because while she got her to go on one journey, her growth is to come back. Think of it this way. When you're born in life, you're born with a spiritual essence. And in the American Indian culture, there's a belief system. And there's that life's path looks like this. You're born with this essence, and then because of a variety of outside sources, your vulnerability, you start the path of life. And as you walk life's path, and you keep walking and walking, going through and responding to life's experiences, you get further and further away from your essence of who you really are, and more unhappy as decades go by. But if you're really lucky and smart, if you have really the ability to have an intent to grow, to really grow, and to give, to evolve spiritually, emotionally, whatever the case may be, and if that intent is followed with action, you don't just think it, oh, I thought it's gonna happen. Thought is energy. Focus is energy. But it takes physical action as well. I got to do something. And if you're lucky and you have the third piece you need, some divine grace. All of us have had it sometime, if we noticed. And if we notice the divine grace and we appreciate it, it expands. If those things happen, we have a lucky moment in our life where we have an awakening. And in that awakening, guess what happens to our life path? We reverse it. And we spend our life going back closer and closer and closer till we arrive back at our essence. And the way that's going to happen is going to be today in this morning session, getting you clear about what is controlling you. If you want to influence someone else and you're a leader, a mother, a father, a friend, a business person, I don't care what kind of leader. Someone who's got influence. If you really want to influence people, you have to know what already influences them. If you want to influence yourself, you better know what influences you already. So I'm going to show you a model for that. I'm not saying it's the right thing. It's a photograph of life, but I think you'll find it useful. You can judge. Give you a few tools. And then I'm going to give you another tool that'll help you kind of evaluate why at different levels of consciousness you look at life so differently. How many have known somebody who's a certain way and you realize, like, and then they do something one day and you're like, what? Where did that come from? Who's had this experience before? I'll tell you where it came from. Same way where her love comes from life, the anger, the joy. Can you be spiritual and still be dark? Yes or no?
Yes.
Can you be funny and still be sad?
Yes.
Can you be spiritual and sexy?
Yes.
Can you be quiet and loud?
Yes.
Did you notice how few people said that time? Did you hear that? All the assumptions we have are where our pain comes from. But we don't want to go into them because, A, we don't know how to go. It's overwhelming. I'm hanging on to what I got. So we manage our suffering with television or movies or problems or business or our children. Here you're not going to manage your suffering. Here you're going to experience your suffering. The thing you're trying to avoid, because once you experience it, no matter what the experience is, it'll turn into joy. The thing you're afraid the most, the fear is what's gripped us. not the real experience. And once you get through that, it's like fear doesn't get a hold of you so easily anymore. And you get really happy with your life, and you're not reacting to life so much, because the mind is a pattern, and if we let that pattern take control of us completely instead of us using it, the mind's powerful. Most of you in this room use your mind to accomplish a lot. Who can relate to this? Your mind's, you've really used it well. But also there are times we don't use it so well, and that's where we get the pain. It uses us. So I want you to know what that pattern is. That's what today. And then, I won't be with you in this, I'll be participating with you, but there'll be one other session where we're going to go deeper into really discovering all of your personalities. Scary thought for some of you, exciting for others. With Sage, I've named them all, because when I first met her, I was like having a conversation, all of a sudden this other person would show up. I'm like, who the hell is this? I literally, in the first 6 months of marriage, I named 12 different personalities. So when they showed up, I knew it was, knew how I could deal with that person effectively. And then I realized I also had a few. Right? But people want to make you one thing, don't they? Because it makes us comfortable. It makes us certain. When I first got involved with Bhagwan and he said, this is what I'd love you to do. And I said, I'd love to do this. And we worked it all out. And so we'll make this thing happen together. It was really amazing. We brought all these people here in May of last year, along with Bhagwan and Amma. And they're all influencers because certain people, just because of their position of life, can touch a lot of other people. And I feel like much is given, you know, much is expected. That's just my belief structure. You got to give it back. So these people I knew are all good people. I brought them. It's great. And then there was a big convention of blessing givers that was done in Los Angeles. And so it was like a week later. So we all came back and, you know, Bhagwan Ram asked us if we'd come. And Nandagiriji was speaking. He said, please come. And he invited everyone to come. Everyone was brand new. And it was the first time it was done in 7 days instead of 21. Now, 21 days, you've suffered more, you've experienced more. There's human needs that are involved in this process, obviously. So I'm thinking everyone's going to be thrilled we're coming, and then all of a sudden I start getting people calling me, and there's some people here shaking their head who are there saying, oh my God, the first morning everybody's pissed off at us and saying, how come you went to Fiji? And then other people said, that wasn't the real process. The real process is 21 days, and I went through the real process. These are these spiritually highly developed human beings, right? And then some of the people, our platinum partners, have become friends with Anandagiriji, and so he held some seats for a few of them because they were personal friends. And, you know, some people, how come they're sitting in the front row? And then the stories about me were mind-boggling from people I'd never met. Would you share what happened there? Am I putting you on the spot in this moment? Would you give him a microphone? It's Anandagiriji, ladies and gentlemen. Can you give them a little feedback about like what people said about me and what the reaction was? I'm curious.
Yes.
This is the personalities piece. When we're done with this, we're going to take a little stretch break. But you might want to hear this and see if this can relate in some way in your own life.
Okay. One of the more popular gossips was, Tonaji is here to take over the oneness movement.
Yeah.
And he's here to steal our contacts.
I just give you a clue, ours was a little bit larger database.
And said he wants our email IDs, our contacts. And in fact, I was totally shocked too. I said, he needs our contacts? And another person, you know, one person asked me, because I was explaining to them what Tonaji was, what his mission was, and I told them that none of you have ever met him. You do not know what he is. He's a very rare human being. And they asked me, are you not tired of defending a man in the garage? I said, no. And one lady popped up and she said, this another gossip. You do not know his past.
Yeah.
You do not know what kind of a person he was. And then I told her, do you know my past? That's not the way you judge a person. And many things like that, Tonaji. Basically, it's like primarily it was people who felt they were very important in the moment. They felt they were becoming insignificant.
Yes.
When somebody comes into the scene who can do much more. And that was the problem they were having with the platinum partners as well.
Yes.
And any other person of influence.
Yes. What was beautiful is Ananda Giriji, I found out about this. I'm hearing all this, and I was exhausted. I hadn't slept, and I was coming to do this program. I wasn't coming for a fee. I wasn't coming for time. Last thing I needed was to fly to L.A. from the part of Asia where I was for 20 hours so I could speak to a group of people that seemed to dislike me and had never met me, not a single one. Right? So when I heard all this, I was honestly feeling hurt and then converting that into anger. And going, why the hell am I doing this? And all these people, and I thought, okay, it doesn't matter. I'm doing it. Why? This is what I'm made for. And I came in, everyone was quiet, and they, you know, like this. I never walked in a room that was quiet, and everybody's like praying. Like I was uncomfortable, you know. Just please sit down. And I started out by saying, I understand some of you have some concerns about me. And the whole room was like, ah. And then within about 15 minutes, we had everybody laughing, and they got that. I didn't think I'm so full of it, and I'm not here to take your job. I just want to support. And eventually, and then people came up to both Sage and I. They also had tons of stories about Sage, which was very fascinating. And we had people come up crying and apologizing to us. But it's this thing that we need to be a certain way. And if someone else is being something we're not, then it must be wrong. And a lot of them is because my silly infomercials they've seen through the years. So they think, you know, I'm Mr. Motivator. One person said, I don't need motivation. I said, that's obvious. Clearly highly motivated in this conversation, right? I'm not a motivator, never have been. That's the media's description. I do believe in energy, I do believe in passion. I know how to get someone who won't sit for a 3-hour movie to go for 50 hours and change their life euphorically at levels they never thought of in one weekend. But I'll tell you something, here's what I am, I'm the why guy. That's what this week's about, why? You clearly, I'm not here to give you motivation. My question is, what is your motive? I believe motive does matter. I think almost everything in my life that's shown up is when it's been most potent, when there's just no way, things have come through me, ideas, insights. It's not been me. It's been when I've really been there. I've not been here. It's been there's someone out there, and I've got to figure out how to serve, and I'm not even thinking, it just boom, it happens. I believe when life works to support life, the more what you're doing is to support more than yourself, the more comes to you. Life supports what supports life at a higher level. Motive does matter. And you do have a motive. I want to know why. Why it is you're so spiritual and yet you're so angry. Or you're so bored. Why it is that you have such beauty and such femininity and you have to be masculine. Or you're so masculine, but you can't accept that. And you always have to be feminine. I want to know why, don't you? I don't know why you say you want this, but you always do the behavior that moves you in the opposite direction. I want to know why you could be in an environment like this and still be frustrated. If you can't make it here, it's fucking over. Try your chance on the next spinning planet, because if you can't find some joy here, Bula all around you, you know, ocean, water, you know, I don't know. I think maybe it's time to just go. You know? If the next look on somebody's face or conversation, what they do or don't do, or the volume or not volume of the music, or the selection that someone made, or how long something goes or doesn't go, can really upset you, I'd like to know why. Because if you're really growing, the beauty of growth is you get so damn comfortable with a part of you that's pissed off, even not judgmental, I'm not supposed to be that, just amazing when you get comfortable with the fact that sometimes you think your mom's a bitch, not defending it, not making it right, not making it wrong, just wow, look at that part of me, shit, I've seen that before. Other people have seen that before. And then you know what happened when I just sat up? You watch this woman, she just smiled from ear to ear. Look at her. Look at her right now. Look at this big grin and big smile, big laugh. You know what part she owns of herself? Naughty. Did you see that? She owns that part of herself. And so she feels joy. There was a point she didn't. She finally said, mother, no mother, naughty. There's some other reinforcement for naughty that probably has helped her in this area, right? Some other feelings of love and connection. So this week, you're going to go on a journey. And if you were going this Indian path, you'd be doing this through time. This is compressed. So it's going to be long, tough, hard, go for it, playful, fun. And you can make this boring. You can make this frustrating. You make this joyful. You can make this the greatest journey of your life. It's all up to you. It's the meaning you're going to give things. Are you going to react and let the mind's old patterns control you, or are you going to discover? And the person going to take you on the journey besides these dasas who are going to be now working with you in small groups every day. We're going to have a morning session, and that session is going to be with Anandagiriji. And Anandagiriji is one of the sweetest souls I know, but I'll tell you something, he's an awakened soul. And I don't say that like a judgment, like he's supposed to be a certain way. I mean there is an aliveness and a spontaneity and a connection to his heart that is unique. And he delivers completely different from me, so it'll fit your perfect spiritual model of quiet and slow. He talks about 1/10 my speed. You'll be waiting, he'll say one word, you'll be waiting about 3 minutes for the second one. But it's three blissful moments, that's the good news, right? And people going to India don't have that experience because Anandagiriji's life, like my own, is traveling the world to open people to the first steps of this so they can begin this journey. So if you're fortunate to spend time with him, it's amazing. He's going to be here with us today. And then after today and tomorrow, we'll start this program, which is a multimedia program with live dasas and facilitators, but little chunks that we can keep under control because I had no idea what I was going to say this morning. So it's different. With video, we keep me under control. And him too, trust me. We both can extend the experience of time. It's one of the reasons I love this man so much. And I see in him, and I love in him things I never loved in myself. Because I love him so much, I love them in me. Same thing with my wife. The very things when I first met her, like, irritated the hell out of me because I loved her. I learned to love those things. Interesting, when I loved those things in her, suddenly I was, like, so much more comfortable with me because I realized those are parts that I've tried to never feel in myself. And now they're alive. Like, work, don't sleep. She loves to sleep. Loves to sleep. Anybody knows me from the years past, I never sleep. I still sleep as little as possible, but I want to be with her, so, and she's mad if I'm up and I leave the bed. So, like, I'm in bed, you know, reading and shit. But we used to have fights because we'd go to bed, like, at midnight, 1, 2 a.m., and it's, like, 11 o'clock in the morning, and she's still in bed, like, you know, first time I came to Fiji, boom, when I used to come here, you talk to any managers that were here in those days. Here's Tony. I created all these activities here. If you'll know, there's climbing the mountain, waterfalls, and I don't even bowl, bowling frickin' alleys, and, you know, water skiing and snorkeling and scuba diving, you know, and I come here and bring a dozen of my friends, and boom, 6:30 a.m., I'm out of bed. Boom, I'm going for my workout, right? Then I'm running up the mountain, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, and going next thing. I had people plan from the moment they opened their eyes to, like, they were complete exhaustion at night. At the end of the week, they're like, that was the greatest week of my life, but I need a vacation after being with Tony. And I came to Fiji one time, never forget, and I jumped out of bed, and she goes, what the hell are you doing? I said, starting my day. She said, get back in bed, I'll show you how to start your day. She goes, but we need more sleep. Now I'll do that. It's still not where I go first, truthfully, but I used to be angry, frustrated. I felt like sleep when you're dead was my approach. But my wife loves sleep. She'll take 10 hours sleep and be quite happy about it. And I adore her, so I love that, so I can do it. Me, work, work, work. She loves to do nothing. She's also, I mean, this thing on the hill would never happen without Sage. She got people to do things. We've worked. We were doing three different cycles of things simultaneously. I'm having to do these two. She's doing these two. It's been unbelievable. So her ability to be productive, that. But she's the only person I know who can own that part of herself and then own the part to just completely let go. And those experiences are beautiful. I went on a trip. Last example, and I'll give you a little stretch break here. Went on a trip with a group of friends of mine, and one of them had just become a friend. Now he's been a friend for 18 years. And you know, you meet certain people, and you just connect. And it's like you don't even know them, and you feel like you've known them forever. A friend, not an intimate, but a friend. And this man and I connected, and I just loved his soul, and I kind of knew who he was, he knew who I was. But we met briefly, and he listened to my tapes, and he's a very famous guy and a very successful man, and it changed his life. He says saved his life. He and his family went away for a weekend down to the Caribbean, and he was at his wit's end in life, and he listened to these, and his whole family listened to them, the entire 30-day program I had there in, 3 days, day and night, night and day, total immersion. So he called me up, said, I want to meet him, met him, felt this just love and connection for him. So then he invited me to go on a trip. He said, here are your two choices. See, I got this group of friends. We've been friends for 15 years. They're all about 18 years my senior. And they're all the best of the best at what they do in the world, all kinds of things, entertainment, business, sports, et cetera, finance. And he says, your choices are, we can go to the Olympics together on a yacht. And he listed who's going to be on the yacht. And we're going to do this thing in the Olympics back in Spain or wherever it was back then. I think it was Spain. He said, or we can go down the Grand Canyon for 2 days, climb up and down, and we'll live in tents, and we'll do this and this and this and this, right? Now, I like the idea of the Grand Canyon, but I was physically burnt out, so that filter of state changed it. So, I absolutely want to go to the Olympics with this even more group of influential people. And I thought, this will grow, and I look at my schedule, and I can't do it. So long story short, we go to the Grand Canyon, and we walk down the Grand Canyon, and it's the hottest it had been in 10 years. And there's no shade in the Grand Canyon. And we're all just burning, melting. And then a sandstorm comes up and everything else. And I'm on this trip, but I've been so exhausted. And I looked around and I saw these people on the trip. Oh, it's just amazing, incredible people. But I looked at how they were all competing for his attention, trying to be significant enough that he would love them more. And I really had the same need. I was no better. I really, even more so, because they'd known him for 18 years. I didn't know him. And I wanted him to know who I really was. And I thought, I'm so tired, I should do something, I should transform something, I should make something happen, so, he'll know who I am, right? But I was so tired, so exhausted, I finally decided, and I saw these people doing anything, I saw myself and these other people too, in a different way, but still me. So I decided to surrender and just take in the trip, and I did not talk very much, I didn't tell stories, I didn't go help anybody, I didn't dig inside and transform things, I didn't do shit. I just played along whatever they did, and they were crazy, and on this trip, some of these people were really crazy and did some crazy shit, and I did all the stuff with them, I did what they wanted to do. And about 4 days into it, I went into a total panic. There's only 2 days left, and I thought, he's never going to know who I am, he's never going to invite me on a trip again, I'm the most boring son of a bitch you could possibly imagine. Right? I've added no value, I've just been here with a ride with everybody else. And a couple other people there are my dear friends. Pat Riley was not a friend until that time, was there, and a couple other people. All really, really interesting, cool people. And I remember one time there was this break, and I just laid down on a rock, and I fell asleep on a rock beside this river. And I woke up to see these six men staring down at me, all super studs of their area like this, looking at me. And I opened my eyes, and a part of me is like, oh, shit, And they all just looked at me, and they're all just silent, and they just said, how do you do it? He said, do what? And I remember Pat being the first one. He said, none of us. We're all still doing our thing, trying to make, trying to impress each other. He said these things. Press each other. Do this. He said, you seem so comfortable with yourself. You're just here for the ride. How do you do it? And I got all this respect and love. I was thinking, shit, relaxing could be a good approach to life. It bonded me with all these people. And they got to see those other parts of me later. I thought that's what I had to be loved, to be appreciated. And also, I had to give, and I hadn't given anything, so I'm worthless. Your model is old. Your model has beautiful parts you're going to want to keep. Your model has other parts that are the source of your pain. You don't want to have to manage your pain anymore. Let's go beyond it. This man's going to take you through that 8-step process, but first, you desperately need to stand up and take a break. Thank you for this morning so far. 5-minute break.